Alright, hello everyone. This is Data Driven Formula One. As usual, Patrick Hens and Ganna Vegrevna here. And today we have a special episode for you where we're going to talk about lessons of leadership, ethics, and values in Formula One.
Yeah, Kana, that's right. I think from sometimes the idea is to include some special episodes about facts which are near to you and to me based on our backgrounds. Also, as far as Formula One is quite an inspiration, I think. In this time, we speak about lessons and leadership because I think it's very interesting if we analyze a little bit what are the visions, the values of these people, the manufacturers who have been successful in the sports and also then have been successful in business, as we speak about Mercedes, Ferrari, Honda. So we speak about company values from organization which come from complete different cultural background. Point in common, of course, all of them had been successful in Formula One. So today we speak about values, leadership. I'm sure later on we also will speak a little bit about other topics which are related to us and the sports, like digital twins, sensors, and so on, simulator.
Definitely. I mean, one of the topics that I particularly am looking forward to covering is girlfriends. So, and how, like, I have a theory that I want to check, and the theory goes like this. I think that dating women from girl bands actually make the performance worse in this sport. But, I don't have a proof of this. It's just anecdotal evidence.
Yes.
But there was a recent, very recent paper in Leadership Quarterly that I saw that said that the kind of sort of the physical attractiveness of a partner makes male leaders perform better, but not female leaders perform better, which is kind of I want to challenge a little bit. But anyway, joking aside, I think today we have a very serious topic, and the cool thing about this, naturally, Formula One had a massive effect on many different areas. And I'm sure we will talk separately about technology, how it affected technology in various industries. But today we will talk also about how Formula One, kind of changed the way people think about ethics and values in leadership. And Patrick will share his kind of experience in compliance.
Yeah,
And I
that's
really
good.
like this. Sorry to keep interrupting you, but I also like the subtitle that you made for this one, for this episode, which is From Corporate Values to Digital Counselor. And I hope
Yes,
you
so
will
in fact,
explain.
we start like this the series, like quite in the past, let's say from the 1950s, and come back to 2020. Just to add, Enzo Ferrari said once about Formula One, it's like it's the ultimate test for the cars. But to add, it's not only the ultimate test for the cars, but also, of course, for the human as the driver, and also how we are working together, human and machine, the ultimate test of efficient processes. I'm sure sometimes we will also discuss in a different episode. How processes have been more efficient. If you see that in the beginning, in the 1950s, a pit stop may take you 1 minute. I remember in the 1980s, if you are under 10 seconds, this was really great. And now it's like 1, 2 seconds and you go again. So it's a big development, not only in the technology itself, but also of our interaction and our processes. But now, for today, we speak a little bit about leadership and value. As you've mentioned, I'm working in the area of compliance, meaning anti-corruption, but also in general business ethics, ethical leadership. And due to this, I discovered the works of W. Edward Deming, who defined the system of the profound knowledge, understanding an organization as a big interlinked system with four main pillars. First of all, the appreciation of a system, the understanding of variation, meaning what, how it changes the, our company, our organization, if we change one detail. This could be not only a detail in the manufacturing, but this could be including a new employee, for example, or also including new technology. And very important for him was psychology, meaning the key factor of success is the human and not the machine. Mm-hmm. And also epistemology, or meaning the need for continuous learning. So with this, Deming understood corporate organizations as one system. And here you have to understand that he started a new part of his career going directly after the Second World War to Japan, where he supported Japanese companies. And the most famous of this has been Toyota, who developed their Toyota way, the way of thinking business quality directly on his ideas. And I would underline that this interaction with Japanese companies not only was going one way, that Japanese leaders and quality experts accepted his ideas, but also he was inspired, I think, by Japanese culture, the way of group thinking, and up to the Shinto religion. So I think it was a very good relation for beneficial for both of them, Japanese companies, and also for himself. And this is how it should be normally, because it should always go in the two ways. So this is the classical system of the profound knowledge. Using it a little bit for our function, if we are speaking about ethics and compliance, I think we can not only interlink employees with processes, with other employees, with customers, providers, with technology, but also, which is, let's say, like a two-dimensional system, but we can include a third new dimension, which is time, meaning we can interlink our processes today, which are back to the founder, because all processes, all internal guidelines which we have today in companies, they are practically based on the vision and the values of the founder, even if this person died many years ago and founded the company like 100 years ago. So we can interlink processes today many times back to the vision of the founder. So we can interlink our today's system to the past, but also, of course, we have to interlink it to a potential point in the future, because we have all companies should have or should have, of course, a strategy, because they have a vision where they want to be in 10, 20 years. So they can. So the actual fit of a company is not only ideal for the situation which we have today, like in 2020, but also we have a strategy as we are changing now the company to a potential envisioned business scenario, let's say in 2030s. So our processes are already going that way, that we adapt them to be efficient to tomorrow's scenarios. Mm-hmm. And this is some of the ideas which I included in my book, The Good System. As a lot of us, we had been a little bit disrupted by the COVID virus, so had some time to do other stuff. And So I thought. Oh,
so is this new? I was gonna ask because yeah, yes. I just realized that you know that this was one book that I haven't seen of yours because.
Yeah, exactly. This, so this is something new where I used the ideas and vision of Deming, of system thinking to use it for the ethics, compliance, legal functions.
Because Patrick has another book which is called Compliance as a Race Car. I really like the book. So yeah, and it is really related to kind of racing and how you can think about compliance and ethics within organizations as a system, as a kind of as a race car system. Yeah. So yeah, but I mean, cool. This is coming out this year, or it has already come out?
This is already available, for example, on Amazon. So a lot of crazy ideas, which I had here in the quarantine of
Oh, wow. Okay. COVID. Yeah, definitely something that I'm looking forward to reading.
Thanks. So let's say if you wanted to include it into a formula, you may say a company is based on the values coming, for example, from the founder. Of course, you have to have an efficient strategy. You have to know where you want to be in the future. And in addition, we have ethics and compliance, which ensures that we stay true to our values and also true to the strategy. And with this, we try to ensure the sustainability of the company.
Mm-hmm.
And due to this, for example, we need to get out of our silos, which we still may find in many companies, but get a more holistic business approach so that, for example, also a compliance or IT department knows what is the strategy, where we are today. So because we have to prepare management for the journey to reach this goal. And so this also important that we are ethical in our business actions and also that our goals are, of course, reachable.
Mm-hmm. And you also mentioned this national culture, right? So how important in your view, you have to forgive me because yes. I haven't read the book yet. I'm sure the answer is there, but you know, the in terms of culture, do you find that these values of the founder are they to some extent influenced by the culture where the leader is from? I mean, if for example, if you have a leader from Japan versus the founder from Japan versus say the founder from Germany. Would the national culture of Japan and national culture of Germany have an impact in these systems? Or do you find that it's kind of more personality over culture?
Of course, each company has its somehow its own culture. But let's say based on my experience working for companies from complete different cultural background, yes, I think even if the big companies today, they are global companies and somehow their culture became more global, but you still perceive the corporate culture similar to the nationality. For example, you see the Daimler culture, which I assume similar to Siemens. You see the German background. While you see in opposite to this, the Ferrari culture still has this not only Italian, but this Latin background. And we come to this in detail. And also Japanese companies, of course, they have a little bit more, they celebrate more the Japanese culture. And you find this in more holistic approaches, more focus on the teamwork in opposite maybe to German or also Latin cultures, which have more focus on a single leader.
So, but in terms of this company identity, if we talk about identity, do you find, again, from your experience, do these large corporations now, do they identify with a particular culture, or it's like it's truly multinational, multicultural identity? So yeah, what I guess what I'm asking is, if your headquarters is in a particular company, does that, in your opinion, impact on the way the culture propagates through the corporation, even if it has multinational structure?
Yes, due to my experience, and let's say this may not statistically be relevant because I not have worked with hundreds of companies, but
obviously
based on this small sample, I think yes, because let's say if you're going to work for a company like Siemens, you feel strongly the German culture, and honestly, companies, as for company, it's for the corporate culture, it's, I think, important to have a kind of identity, which is based on the founder, but it's also often based on the local culture where the company come from. So it's a simple example, independent where in the world you may celebrate the typical celebrations from the country where the company is coming from. Yeah, for example, you may all over the world in the offices from, let's say, Siemens, celebrate the Oktoberfest, or you in Japanese companies, you may celebrate like the Japanese spring, for example. So you try to have this relation to your home country and make it part also of the corporate culture, including like celebration days, for example.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Okay. So let's look at some examples, I guess, of...
Exactly. So let's come to the practical point. And what I did here, I did some investigations on the internet. Most of the bigger companies, they publish their code of ethics on their website because they are proud of it, and it's important that their customers and providers know what are the processes, what is the vision, what are the values of my company, so what you get working for me or working with me. So most companies have defined corporate values together with mission or mission. And also, as these car companies, which we see today, they have been founded by quite famous people. It's quite easy to Google a little bit and find their quotes. Most of the examples, you may understand that the corporate values, which are still officially defined today, are really related to the founders and their vision, how they saw the business and the world. So going to Daimler, and the photo, of course, is Gottlieb Daimler. If we see today's values of the company, which you find, by the way, if you're curious, I always put the links directly to the code of conduct. There they define corporate values are respect, passion, discipline, and integrity. Okay. So these are really the core values, and theoretically all processes of a company should be based on the corporate values. And if you think a little bit what is related to motorsports, as Daimler was quite early engaged in motorsports, only had these decades where they stopped based on the accidents, but as we all know, they returned to Formula One. They also had been active in Indianapolis. So they really are doing motorsports on the highest level, and I think for years now, they are really the benchmark for successful motorsports. So we see important respect, which you have for your co-workers, your customers, your discipline, but let's say directly related to sports. Of course, we need the discipline. Without discipline, we cannot be successful in on the highest levels of professional sports. And of course, even if, let's say, Germany is not really well known for being a country with lots of emotions, passion is one of the corporate values of the Daimler company. And I think this is really important for motorsports. Mm-hmm. And here
the mission. I really like the mission.
Yeah. So really, one of the most famous quotes, I think, from Gottlieb Daimler is the best or nothing. And I mean, this is the mindset to win championships. As many others said, there are no points for being second best. The idea is Daimler is not participating, so they don't have maybe the Olympic spirit, but really they are in Formula One to win. And for this, you need, of course, integrity, respect, very important, the discipline and the passion. So, mm-hmm. So I think here we see that, clearly that the values of the company, why Daimler-Benz is a successful organization selling cars, trucks, etc. Mobility is also directly supported by their positive experience from motorsports.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I really like this quote. So I think I will use it with my students.
Yeah. Important, of course, the best or nothing. This is the goal for the long run. So you have to have a strategy because you cannot start getting the best results. But so you have a clear strategy. For this, you have the discipline. And after some years, you started entering Formula One. I mean, when they re-entered now in Formula One, the first seasons, they really had not been successful, but they stayed on the plan, and now they are winning every championship for years now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And with this company from a complete different cultural background, we see here the corporate values from the Ferrari organization, which is not only the race team, but really the company, the car manufacturer. Interesting, they have some quite interesting combinations. So first one, the individual and the team. So I think this is a very important point. Often companies foster the teamwork and forget a little bit to foster and support also the individual. So Ferrari clearly underlines that the individual is important, and this is I think not against the idea of system thinking, because if we see back Deming, for him psychology is one of the key pillars. So really each individual is important, so we have to support the individual that he/she can move up inside the organization, and with this the individual may form a successful team.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and indeed, when we discussed Enzo Ferrari, I just remember we looked at this photo when there was Mark Hawthorn and Enzo Ferrari. And you would expect, kind of after reading everything about Enzo Ferrari, that he would probably be given orders, but you could see in that photo that there is like a mechanic and Enzo Ferrari and Mark Hawthorn, and you can see that they're kind of submerged into this sort of discussion, and you can tell that it's not that type of relationship that I tell you what to do. It's really a collaboration, a collaboration.
It is a combination. Of course, Enzo Ferrari was the person who took the decision, and if needed, he said where to go. So, and maybe it was difficult to influence his decision, but it was not that he was not near to the team. I mean, they are many stories. For example, when the Ferrari engineers had to do overtime because they had to reach a particular goal, that he came in the evening into the plant bringing bread, salami, red wine to support the engineers who had been working until midnight and still longer, and so, and ate shared the food with his engineers because he really understood the importance of each employee.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the next point, I think if you think about Ferrari, no surprise, they really included emotion as one of their corporate values. So not completely different than Daimler, who had passion as one of their core values. So also Ferrari has emotion as one of their corporate values. And I think successful companies, you should include psychology and emotion as really one of your core values, because employees want to be proud where they are working, they are up to, they want, of course it's hard work, but also of course they should have fun doing their work. So I think emotion, passion, as the other value, are very important for successful organizations.
Mm-hmm.
Next, so I already mentioned.
I quite like how the quote that you picked so for this.
Yeah, and me too. That's he had a very long successful life. There are hundreds of biographies and there are hundreds of quotes, and I come back to this, why I have chosen that quote. Also important is the combination of tradition and innovation. So important, we cannot stay in the past, but we have to evolve as a company. We have to evolve our products. If not, someday we are not needed by society anymore and will fade away. And I think also, there is this tradition of innovation. So really this is something what has to be combined, as of course, even if we innovate, we should not forget what are the ideas of our founders, because they are very big inspiration to find new ways, new solution. And again, for me, it's the tradition of innovation.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks that you like my quote. So Enzo said a lot of things you may Google it in the internet. I've chosen these lines today. Factories are made of people, machines and bricks. Ferrari is made mostly of people. Again, if we saw Deming's system of profound knowledge, psychology is one of the key pillars, if not the most important part. And I think here he nearly predicted how business is now with Industry 4.0, where a lot of our unnecessary tasks get automated. And for us, it is important that we foster the human skills like ingenuity, creativity. So this is a very good mindset, especially now for digital transformation, which is more a human transformation than a technical transformation. So to be successful with Industry 4.0, you have to be aware that your key factors of winning or losing are the people and maybe not directly the tools we are using.
Yeah, and I guess this also kind of highlights the importance of the human capital and how, exactly. You know, how I think the importance of human capital was only highlighted even in economics works much later than Ferrari started his business. So, the value of human input into organizational processes was highlighted by him much earlier than, or at least he understood it much earlier than the economists did. So yeah, so that's another cool thing about this vision.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and also here, if you see Ferrari's corporate values, I mean, they are clearly aligned to motorsports. I mean, emotion, passion, individual, the driver, but the driver is nothing without the team. But even if you have the best group of engineers, mechanics, team, car, you nevertheless you need the best driver to win the championship. And in the last seasons, we spoke about Fangio, and here we had mostly the case. We had Fangio being the best driver, but also Fangio being in the best car, and this was, in many ways, the winning combination. We had also other very good cars, and also we had many other very good drivers, but we had very good drivers, maybe not sitting in the best car or having the best car, but not having the best driver. So really important, individual and team, both have to be combined to make it work if you want to achieve success. And this is really valid up to today. If we see today's Formula One, we see Mercedes-Benz being the benchmark in Formula One for various seasons, but also Lewis Hamilton, he's one of the best, even if not the best driver right at the moment. So we have the best driver and the best car winning the championships.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh, Honda. This Honda, is yes. Very interesting one.
Exactly, and I wanted to point out here a little bit also the Japanese culture, as maybe sometimes when if we see Japan people, how people imagine Japanese work culture, often the focus is of course being a Japanese working much more hours than Europeans. Or in the US, for example, so we imagine Japanese people in gray suits sitting in big offices working on computers, which is partly true, but of course it's also a little bit cliche. Most big Japanese companies are aligned to Japanese philosophy, up to Shinto. So they really align their work with such ideas, and they like to see what they want to achieve is that their employees really can develop inside the companies, but also that they are happy in their work. So they have a lot of internal programs supporting this kind of a philosophy, up to that most Japanese companies have a high focus on sustainability, because based on Japanese culture, they want to achieve 3 points, that the company is happy, meaning they're doing business, their customers are happy, including the partners as providers, but also the society is happy with the company. So it's very important that they get perceived as a good corporate citizen. This Honda, I assume, is also a little bit different, as really Honda and his founder, Soichiro Honda, was very passionate about motorsports, and which I think you see also in the corporate values, which are still defined today in the company. So first value is dreaming, which I think normally you would not think this is the first value of a Japanese company, but really Honda defined dreams as one of their corporate values, and you can understand it a little bit if you try to understand more Japanese culture. Again, similar as Daimler, similar as Ferrari, so similar to companies which have coming from complete different cultural background. Also, they have emotion with dreams, but also especially with joy. So people should enjoy working for Honda, including, of course, the customers should enjoy their products.
Yeah, I just wanted to add that the dreams is very like on the dreaming part, that this culture of kind of dreaming is very, very much kind of within the Asian tradition, because I think the point is to kind of have a big dream towards which you make kind of this relatively small steps, right? But it's important to set the bar very, very high and then kind of go to it. Even if you don't reach the bar, you still reach something like very big. So in that sense, the dream actually makes perfect sense.
Exactly. For example, you say you have to shoot for the stars to reach the moon. Or also one other famous quote from Enzo Ferrari, if you can dream it, we can build it. So successful entrepreneurs always, of course, start with a dream. And then they make the plan to how to reach this dream. It's a high challenge, of course. Mm-hmm. I think the next value, the third one, of course, it's directly coming from motorsports, this challenging spirit, being the best. Clearly, this is the way how you win Formula One titles, as also Honda did. And respect, I mean, this would be the typical Japanese value, but remember, respect also is one of the key values from the Daimler organization. So we see here similarities between the different companies, independent from which culture you come. Most of the corporate values, the attitudes, they are quite similar, because this is, let's say, the mindset to win titles and not only participate.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah. Yes, and I think what we discussed is also directly inside this quote: action without philosophy is a lethal weapon, but philosophy without action is worthless. So it's saying, of course, you have to have the dream, but then you have to start action to achieve this dream.
Yeah, and I just wanted to kind of also mention despite the fact that we've seen quite a few Japanese companies in the Formula One, we do not see them consistently there. They're kind of in and out, or they work in collaboration with others. And the anecdotal sort of, I don't have like obviously any, you know, hard statistical proof of this, but kind of the anecdotal reasoning for why, you know, the companies like Toyota or Honda are not as successful as the other teams is that in Japanese culture, it takes time, you know, you take time to make a decision, right? And from what I heard from several friends who worked for the Japanese Formula One teams, that it took normally quite a long period of time to take a weighted decision. And at Formula One, you often need like this kind of snappy, you know, quick, dynamic decisions. You know, it works well, we have to say, like in strategic terms, right? It works really well for Japanese companies who achieve great success in probably other strands for example, in engineering and in other markets where you need to make cars. But probably Formula One is one of the exceptions here, because it really requires very dynamic, fast decisions.
Yeah, but let's say Honda achieved this. They've been very successful with McLaren, Honda.
But what I'm saying is, like, you don't see them there consistently. It's not like, you know, Ferrari we've seen for, you know, since 1950 to now, and McLaren as well. But we saw, for example, I remember there were several seasons where we saw Toyota, and I did some, when I did research on budgets, I remember that, for example, Toyota at one point had the highest budget, but one of the worst results in the season.
That's right. I mean, it would be an interesting topic to discuss. But I think there have been different factors. I mean,
Absolutely. I don't want to degrade the achievements of Japanese teams by no means, but I'm just saying that the, you know, this is what I heard as a sort of as a kind of anecdotal accounts of why people felt that didn't work out. Yeah.
Yes, I mean, as I said, it would be an interesting example to discuss, but because on the other hand, I might argue that maybe the problem with Toyota in Formula One was that they not had been Japanese enough, because at, I think it was developed by Toyota Europe. It was their headquarters was in Cologne, Germany, a place where very far away from everything from Formula One related. So I think you may even say the other way around. Maybe they had been successful if the team had been based in Japan directly. And so it was a little bit a mixture of different cultures. Also, it's not included in the beginning real Formula One experts, as it was the people worked had been successful before in the Rally Championship and then decided to switch from Rally to Formula One. And so the engineers people working had been knowledgeable about Rally, but there'd be no real Formula One experts.
Yeah, but that's exactly what, well, not exactly, but that's kind of in line with what you're saying. Like, so what I heard is that by the time, every time you need to make a decision, you need to ask a central office in Japan. So by the time you kind of send the message there, by the time the reply comes back, it normally, you know, takes time. So that was kind of one of the reasons that I heard was the issue. But I mean, of course, it was not the only issue. I'm sure that there were other things.
As you remember in our earlier episode where we spoke about 1957, what you mentioned is that the US races, the IndyCar series, as let's say half or even more than half of the championship this season are ovals, which are highly predictable. And one of the topics Toyota had maybe also is that they not only focus on Formula One, but they had been for a long, long time successful in the IndyCar series. Let's say this sports, as it's more predictable as Formula One, would maybe benefit companies which maybe a little bit takes a little bit longer the decision making itself, but therefore they have a more extended decision making process, thinking more about the decision, thinking more in the long time. So maybe the IndyCar series for such an Asian company is easier than the more chaotic Formula One.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Anyway, very interesting topic. I'm sure when we get to Japanese teams in Formula One, it will be very interesting.
Exactly.
To talk about that. Okay.
And with this, we're coming to a smaller.
Oh, Bruce McLaren.
Yeah. I mean, as you had some contacts with McLaren, I don't know if you like to.
But yeah, I will just listen to you on this one. Yeah, so I think, definitely very, very cool team. And I'm looking forward to when we get to talk about them and about the Bruce McLaren, in fact, in the seasons when we get to them in chronology. But definitely very cool team and very interesting culture. And based in, in the heart of England, you can say. And definitely very interesting operation, especially when we had McLaren-Mercedes operation, where you had part of the team in Woking, part of the team in Stuttgart. Yeah. And all of this worked really well. So, yeah.
Yep, and here we have the corporate values. And to be honest, McLaren as a company, as you know, they are a very small car manufacturer, but let's say they are mostly a racing team.
Absolutely.
In opposite to Honda, Daimler, or even Ferrari, which are professionally car manufacturers today. Nevertheless, also they have defined corporate values. They underline the idea of the team. So all of their values start with V. So first, we innovate. So again, we have the tradition of innovation as in Ferrari defined. We do everything for a reason. So again, you have to have the dream and have the plan how to get to achieve this dream. You may compare it to Honda, and we do not compromise, similar to Daimler, not the best or nothing. So very, again, you see four companies, complete different cultural backgrounds, but somehow the corporate values are all the same. And this may answer a little bit your question from the beginning. So it seems that the place where you're coming from is maybe not that relevant, but the mindset of the founder and all of them, they not have been in the sports to participate only, but really with the clear goal to win and to have this mindset. It seems that this is similar, independent if you're coming from a highly individual society like the US or a more social and team-oriented society as Japan.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but at the same time, I think in the formulation of this, we definitely see if in the previous slides you mostly had nouns. Here we have very powerful verbs, which is, I think, very much this in Anglo-Saxon culture, right? It's more describing actions rather than sort of just having statements of something. Yeah.
Yep. Also here, a quote from the founder itself, Bruce McLaren. He said, to do something well is so worthwhile that to die trying to do it better cannot be full-heartedly. It would be a waste of life to do nothing with one's ability. For I feel life is measured in achievement, not in years alone. Mm-hmm. Also, some clear vision for his life and his company.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it kind of reminds you like Daimler values, but formulated in a very British way, whatever Anglo-Saxon way. Let's just say with verbs rather than just saying, best or nothing. We do not compromise, which is like, I think, very, very similar.
Exactly. And then last example is Red Bull, a little bit different approach. As you know, Red Bull started with this energy drinks. And then they started getting active in all kinds of sports, starting, let's say, from extreme sports, going to less extreme sports.
To more extreme sports and then to less extreme sports.
They started in very extreme sports and then went to less and less to more commercial sports. So I think before buying two Formula One teams, they had been active in the World Rally Championship. And then they went to a little bit more less extreme, but more commercial Formula One. And after this, they bought. I hope I'm good in with the timeline. But also now they have different kind of football clubs or soccer clubs for the guys in the US in the various mm-hmm. Countries. So, and I think the idea is, and this is similar to a guy which we discussed in the earlier episode, like Tony Vanderwerf, who said, to be successful, I need a budget, I need a strategy. And the idea of Red Bull is to use their engagement, like in Formula One or also in football, not as pure marketing, but they really want to have these clubs, these Formula One teams, sustainable, meaning making money. So they not want, of course, they invest money, but they also, the idea is to not waste money, but up to get money out of this investment. So it's not really marketing, but really the idea is that they have these Red Bull teams, they have the two teams, but they should be successful, and meaning they should earn the money they are spending.
Yeah.
Okay. And regarding Formula One, I think we have the two teams. We have the number one team, the Red Bull, which I forgot which was the name before of this team. But I think Alpha Tauri, this their second team, Toro Rosso, known before, and was the former Minardi team, very small Italian team, which everybody loves. So maybe we have to do a special episode about just Minardi one day. Also interesting, the only one of the founders who is still living, but unfortunately I didn't find a photo in public domain. Up to in Wikipedia, there is none, so we have this graphic.
Okay.
Okay, so corporate values from the Red Bull organization, people, ideas, culture. So sounds like a modern hipster company, very hipster values. So people, ideas, culture, and this is the way Red Bull, I think, became famous. And also one quote from him, it is a must to believe in one's product. I mean, similar as we see with Honda, with Ferrari, you have to have the dream and you have to believe in yourself. And with this, you're able to reach it. Of course, not only believing, but also acting accordingly. Okay, so let's move on a little bit, speaking about process versus people responsibility. And I know you had here one example.
Yeah. So just, I guess at this point, I wanted to mention that when we talk about Formula One, one of the main lessons it provided for the rest of the industries is that when we're talking about kind of corporate responsibility and understanding how to approach various mistakes and errors and all this, you address a process, you do not punish the people. So you basically try to change the process. So we've discussed a lot of earlier seasons so far, and we've talked about how, you know, audience, like people from the audience were involved in some fatal accidents, and how, you know, the sport addressed the processes around, you know, kind of letting people close to the track. And here, yeah, I think this is one of the most kind of the brightest examples of trying to improve the process, trying to address the improvements in the process rather than, you know, punishing people. And to me, this is kind of the story of this lollipop man in the pit stops. So actually, the story that I read in many blogs was that the original lollipop man came about from the Nigel Mansell's 1991 Williams incident, let's just say, at the pit stop when his car was kind of let out too early from the pit stop and he lost the wheel. And the reason for that was that the sign for moving forward was to, like, one of the mechanics who had to wave the hand. But he was waving the hand for a different reason. But actually, I just, so in preparation for this episode, I watched, it just so happens, Nigel Mansell's 1991 Portuguese Grand Prix, where this happened. And he was driving, obviously, FW14 car, which is a Williams, like very famous Williams car. And there is already a lollipop man present in this incident. So it did happen when the lollipop man was there. But effectively, yes. I mean, the point was that the introduction of lollipop man was there so that there is one person that kind of observes the whole pit stop activity. And then when, you know, everyone is ready, then he lifts the lollipop and that's the signal for the driver to go. Whereas someone kind of just waving the hand, which was kind of very confusing and mistakes could happen. And, you know, you could, well, in this case, in the case of Nigel Mansell, he completely lost an opportunity to win the season as a result of this mistake. So the lollipop men, they originated from these incidents, right? And it was not so noticed that, you know, in Formula One, the people were not punished, but rather they tried to introduce a different process. So they introduced this lollipop man who was standing with this big thing, the lollipop, and showing when you could move out from the pit stop. But then, you know, in recent years, by 2013, we had the majority of teams switched to this automatic signage. But as we know, that also leads to mistakes. And in the last few years, we saw several examples when it didn't work very well. And as the signaling, the automatic signaling can also fail. But again, the culture around addressing these issues and addressing mistakes is not to punish specific people who might have made a mistake, but rather to quickly address the process. And that's something that was picked up by other industries. And that's why it's a significant cultural example that came from Formula One.
Yeah, I think this is a great example. Also, when we go back to the beginning of this this video, speaking about system thinking, we see that many of these companies, like Ferrari, like Honda, they put emotion as one of their core values. So emotion, of course, in general, something positive. But let's say if we have on a very emotional situation, as for example on a Grand Prix weekend, we are so much inside the situation, we act and because we want to win the best or nothing. And here important is sometimes we need, this is something which companies can learn from this process of having the lollipop men. We need a process which sometimes stops us down. For example, speaking about decision making, there's the cup of coffee rule. Before taking and making an important decision, have a cup of coffee. If it's possible, sleep one night before taking and making an important decision. So as Deming included human psychology, processes have to be based on the knowledge of behavioral science, because humans tend to
make mistakes.
Tend to make mistakes and tend to fall on psychological pressures. We have a different kind of biases, so sometimes we really have to stop down, think about it, maybe think a little bit more, have a little bit more extended decision-making process. So especially in emotional situations, like of course in Formula One, but also we have this in normal companies. So we really have to ensure that our decisions are adequate. So we need to get stopped like by a lollipop man from time to time, especially before we take relevant decisions. And also, as you pointed out, this special case with Nigel Mansell. So we had the lollipop man, and it seems that the lollipop man didn't give any other signal to Nigel, but why Nigel nevertheless accelerated? Maybe because of the rear mirrors, which are, by the way, an invitation based on motorsports, which later came to the normal streetcars. So maybe he was looking in his rear mirror and saw the mechanic waving. Mm-hmm. And based on this waving, started to accelerate, as this was, let's say, the sign of a sign in the past to accelerate. And this is also another important rule, how we implement efficient decision making into a company. We need clear signals. We cannot have a situation where if a lollipop man says wait and the mechanic says go, because mm-hmm. then we are getting confused and take the wrong decision. Because also for this, important for success, not only in company, but also in motorsports, is respect, and due to this, we see respect as a corporate value. We really have to respect to the signal from the person in charge, which is the lollipop man. And so if we see two different signals from coming from two different people, two different colleagues, we have to respect the signal coming from the person in charge, which in this case is the lollipop man.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yes, indeed. So very important. I mean, I think this is one of the main contributions of Formula One to the rest of the industries.
Okay, so with this, let's look a little bit into the future and going back about speaking about compliance, business philosophy. We are in times of digital transformation where a lot of processes get transferred, especially robotic process automation, which takes away our workload from daily tasks, which are highly standardized. So due to this, the machine can do itself a combination of different pushing the buttons where really no human is needed. So let's say, especially if you're working in the ethics and compliance department, one of your key partners should be the IT department, and this aligned with James Bond, where practically in each James Bond movie, James visits Q to see the latest gimmicks which he needs, and of course inside in the movie later has to use. So luckily that he really has Q, and he went in the beginning to his laboratory, because if he would not have this one particular gimmick, most likely the big bad guy would have killed him. So really there are a lot of stuff which the IT department can support, including up to the implementing a chatbot like a digital counselor, which we will see at the end. Also, I mean, as I've mentioned with Deming, this is not only for a one-way communication, but also it's quite an inspiration, because especially in IT department, you find people thinking about the future, what is possible in 5 years, what technical possibility have. So it's really quite, mostly quite inspirational to speak with the IT guys. If you're working in companies, also sometimes go to the basement and speak with your IT guys.
Yeah, like the IT crowd. Who always are in the basement. Yeah, but generally, yeah. I think it doesn't only apply to IT equally. If you are in IT, you might want to talk to people in other departments. So I think it's just important. I think you can't really emphasize it enough that you always need to, if you want an out of the box kind of understanding of your area, you always need to talk to people outside of your area. So effectively, you just need to find people in other departments that you could talk to.
Exactly. If we speak about forming a team between artificial intelligence and human, the idea is normally, and we see this often now in customer service, the level one support is done by the machine, by the algorithm. And if this is not working, then the human, of course, is the key factor. I must say that, Ganna, you assume somewhere in the internet found this photo. I lived 10 years in Mexico City, and I do not know that museum. Maybe it's
No, I just thought that was really cool. I mean, I really like this robot. I mean, I haven't been to this museum, but it sounds like a museum to visit.
Maybe it's new. I have to Google it, because mostly I'm once a year in Mexico City.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, but definitely. I mean, it would be very interesting to see how like hybrid human bot systems will work. Yeah. I still think that, yeah, Formula One is quite a difficult, contextually very difficult sport to manage. So there is, obviously we will see some automation, but probably we will not see like it being completely automated for quite a while, because like we mentioned before, it's full of surprises. Because it's full of surprises, every circle is full of surprises. It's quite unlikely that we will have machines. I mean, it would be interesting to actually design a bot that would actually drive the car through the circuit, but I guess it would take ages to create one that would actually do it with precision of a Formula One driver.
I don't want to disappoint you, but exactly this we already have. We have this a company who is doing autonomous race cars.
There are a lot of autonomous races, and even now they have also the championship, right?
No drones, real cars, not so really. Mm-hmm. And I think they presented their car last year or 2 years in the Goodwill Festival in the UK. The idea is to create a series of autonomous races. But I mean, I don't think it's much a technical question, but I mean, why is Formula One successful? I don't think it's only because of the technology, but also about the drivers, the teams, about the heroes. Of course, also the tragical accidents, they're also a part of the history. So I think why people like to see Formula One, it's not because of seeing cars going around the circuit, but really because it's somehow also a human story. So
But at the same time, we have, I don't know whether it exists outside of UK, but in UK there is this a TV program. I mean, it doesn't run anymore, but it used to be very successful. I think it's called Robot Wars, where you have like robots fighting in the ring. And, you know, which is, it's a quite violent program, I have to say. But, you know, in terms of, so I guess it's something along those lines, like you're basically creating technology of like that would allow you to do Robot Wars in Formula One setting. So I guess it would have its own audience of some sort, but definitely not the audience that, the sport currently has. And the reason is, of course, that you're absolutely right, Patrick, is that, you know, you want to see how humans are making decisions in these highly risky environments. That's all it's all about. And that's how you combine the vulnerability of human with the precision of the machine, and how that works together. And this, in fact, is the reason why the two-way telemetry was prohibited very quickly. There is reasonable level of automation, and there is not reasonable level of automation, and the two-way telemetry where you could steer the car from outside was probably not the best thing to do.
Going back to your lollipop example, the lollipop man has a relative dangerous position, because if the driver accelerates too early, he's driving over this poor guy.
Yeah, absolutely. And we had cases when these folks have been hit by the cars.
Exactly. So due to this, it was some years ago, we implemented in Formula One the virtual lollipop man. So it was just then, I think, a light on the steering wheel.
On the previous slide, we have them. If you go back to the previous slide, we had one more. So there is, as you can see, there is one where there is a person that kind of holds one, and then there is just an automated.
Yes, and I think there was 2 years ago we had the. Nevertheless, a problem
Still there are problems. Yeah, yeah.
that the that now the algorithm, so the robot was not working correctly, so and so the algorithm showed the green when it shouldn't still be on red, and due to this the driver, I think it was Ferrari, accelerated while the mechanic was already working on the wheel, which injured the mechanic. I think, yeah, I'm quite sure it was Ferrari, and I think the mechanic broke his arm. I think after this they went back to a human lollipop man.
I mean, I think this is an interesting, again, very, very interesting collaborative process and process improvement dynamic in the sport when you're trying to find the best way of doing something. Yeah.
Exactly. So quite interesting. And this shows, I mean, the importance that we really have to work efficiently together, algorithm and human, and also what we call collaborative robots, that the programming of the robot really has to ensure that it protects the human employee, independent how stupid the employee is acting.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
And with this, I'm coming to an interesting article, which was co-authored by Ghana. So
maybe let's pause and then do it again about from this slide. Okay.
Yeah, the problem is Amazon just passed by.
Okay.
Normally nothing happens here, but the one, two times Amazon is coming by.
Okay.
So
I will do the applause again so that I know I need a marker for this.
Yeah, thanks.
Okay,
and with this we are coming to a concept which I like to call the digital counselor, which should align what we discussed in the beginning of this presentation, that a corporate culture, corporate processes, they are all aligned with the ideas, vision of the corporate founder. So, and here I found a very interesting text, which was co-authored by you, Ghana. So maybe you like to comment on that.
Yeah, so this is a paper that we've done with my co-author, Eamon Shizema, who is a professor of strategy, and he's very interested in governance and how, you know, leadership is affected by various structures. And the point of this work was to kind of one of the things that we've found through this work was that if you just impose a social norm of good leadership, so in fact, if you just ask people, what would a good leader do in this situation, then all of a sudden they become basically more sincere and honest, and abstain from things like bribery or corruption. And we kind of try to test this experimentally, so we create a lot of incentives for people to be dishonest in a way in this experiment. So we kind of provoke them to make these dishonest decisions. And we give them all sorts of incentives and different treatments. So sometimes we give them financial incentives to be honest. Sometimes we give them sort of the kind of responsibility incentives when they are responsible for other people, to be honest. But all of this kind of has an effect. I can't say that it doesn't have an effect. It does have an effect. However, this simple thing, just asking them what would a good leader do in this situation, has more effect than anything else that we've kind of designed through the experiment. And that certainly shows you that the norm is very important. So the social norm in which the leader is working is extremely important. And Yeah, it's not every time. I was telling Patrick before we started filming this episode, it's not every day you see a quote of yourself on the slides prepared by someone that you work with. But so thanks to Patrick for this. So we tried multiple rewards and punishment and creating incentives in that sense. So we had like fines and we had rewards, financial rewards that we would give to people, but none of that worked as well as just imposing the social norm, which basically just tells you that we don't work enough with culture, organizational culture, and we try to often solve problems based on some financial incentives, and financial incentives is not all. And in fact, you know, coming back to Formula One, we have really good example of that. Like I remember in one of the seasons of Ferrari introduced the monetary rewards for winning a particular race. And we only saw a temporary effect of that. So then they appreciated that it has to be non-pecuniary reward. And I think they performed a lot better after they've decided that that probably wasn't a very good idea. So yeah, you know, all these financial incentives do work. I can't say that they don't work, but the effect fades away very quickly. And if you want to achieve a long-term effect, then you need to work with culture.
Yeah, I agree. I may add that, of course, such a fine, I mean, most of, a lot of the positions inside a company, they have an annual
bonuses
based on the success, based on behavior. And I think it's not only the, if you speak about motivation, I think it's also a sign of respect that if a company is successful, that it's somehow shared. So I think it should exist as a base. So let's say I would see, as described in psychology, if this would go away, this would have a negative effect. So if this is not, it would make employees unhappy if it not exists, but it does not additionally motivate the employees. And let's say due to my personal experience regarding ethics and compliance systems, I mean, they're really independent of all defined processes, tools, controls, the really de facto if something works or not is the tone from the top, because employees look at their leaders. If they are behaving ethically, they try to behave ethically. I mean, if they see they're not, then it's very difficult to make such an ethics and compliance system efficiently working. Mm-hmm. Besides this, why I've used this particular article is because, as you mentioned here, and as you can see in this article, people ask them what would be a good leader do, and who is a good leader? Let's say, as I speak, of course, the actual management. But also, of course, if you're working for Daimler-Benz, you may say Gottlieb Daimler was a good leader. If you're working for Ferrari, and I think he would even have it stronger because the company is very much aligned with this one person. So you may ask this yourself, if you have a problem, what would Enzo Ferrari do in my situation? And I mean, the good thing is, we are in times of digital transformation, we can bring at least the cognitive part back of our original founder. And for example, this is a topic which we discuss in the working group of the IEEE Digital Reality Initiative, where we discuss the possibility of cognitive twins. You know, digital twins are quite common today of machinery. You may have digital twins of organizational processes, structures, but also, of course, you may have cognitive digital twins of human individuals. So you may program, let's say, a chatbot acting on the same visions, ideas, attitudes as one person. You may program its relation to risk-taking, if it's risk-averse or is quite open to take on risks. So you may program such a bot, and you can do this even with software which you find on the internet for free. So I did here a small example which I programmed myself. So this is really just a little place. So this bot is not doing anything more than what you can see on this little dialogue. So let's say we have this Enzo Ferrari chatbot. You have a question for this, and you would like, you are interested to understand how Enzo Ferrari would act in this situation. Mm-hmm. So you see, I'm contacting as an employee the chatbot. I'm saying hello Enzo. Then he asks, greets back, dear human, nice to meet you. My name is Enzo, born in 1898 in the Italian city of Modena. And I'm as a friendly employee, I'm saying, nice to meet you. And then the bot asks me, what do you want to speak with me about? And I'm curious if I can accept an invitation from a provider to, let's say, to an entertainment event, a concert. And I'm asking Enzo, can I accept the invitation for an entertainment event? The bot normally tries to confirm that it understood my questions and asked me, do you want to speak with me about the acceptance of entertainment? I confirm with yes. And then the Enzo bot says, a man has no need of entertainment. Entertainment only distracts from his duty. If a man has his duty, that is enough. So this is an original quote from Enzo Ferrari. Mm-hmm. And the good thing is using Enzo Ferrari for this example is because he's very well known. There are hundreds of biographies. So you can make a picture, a simulation, what has been his idea. So it's easier to model like somebody like, let's say, Bruce McLaren, about whom we not have so much documentation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But so really cool. Oh, yeah.
Okay, so I have first his quote, and by the way, if you're working a big company, for example, like in Siemens, and you have the idea to do something like this, big companies often have a corporate museum where you find a lot of documents about the founder. So if you're interested, you can go to the corporate museum and do some investigations, which, for example, okay. So first I have this quote from Enzo, and then I translate this to a direct recommendation. And then, so the Enzo bot continues, employees should avoid the acceptance of entertainment by third parties. So this is something which you find as a rule in many corporate guidelines. Normally all documents say, try not to accept gifts and entertainments from
parties.
So then here, let's say he gives the recommendation based on the guidelines, and then he gets more specific. If you want to attend a particular entertainment event, please get your manager's approval, which would be the clear rule which is defined in the guideline. Mm-hmm. And I'm speaking here about a potential Ferrari guideline regarding gifts and hospitality. As I assume it could be, I don't know if they really have this guideline, but I know most of companies have similar guidelines. So this would be how a chatbot could react if I would ask it that question. Mm-hmm. And yeah, this, of course, is a very simple technology, as you can find for free on the internet. You can program something like this quite easily yourself. You have to have some basic programming skills, but really it's like basic. So it's like an if-then connection. So it's nothing like machine learning. It's pure if-then connections.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sounds good.
Yep, and let's say, and this is all, and by the way, and I found this quote from a very nice video from the Ferrari company, which they made to collaborate the anniversary of the Enzo's death. So here we have a quote by John Elkann, the chairman of Ferrari. And what he says is, the priority is to carry on the spirit of the founder of this company. Ferrari is determined to build a future that lives up to its glorious past. So it's, I mean, especially based on this quote, I think having something like a digital counselor is a good option, because here the technology supports us to carry on the spirit of our founder, which really should help us, especially in situation where we are in doubts what the company expects from us and what not.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. And that's a fun tool, I think. Yeah, because it kind of refers you to the actual quotes of the person that lived at one point, rather than just having a chatbot.
Exactly. So this is something, and honestly, this is not pure science fiction. For example, yeah. Salvador Dali Museum in Spain. I don't know if they have it anymore, but they had some exposition where, as a visitor, Salvador Dali avatar, chatbot, whatever, explained to you he was thinking doing these paintings, and you also could interact with this virtual Salvador Dali, a little bit similar as here in my example.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, definitely very, very fun too. Yeah, I think it's really cool.
Yeah, thanks. So again, so I think, and this is what we have in various of our episodes, Formula One is, I think, a very good inspiration for us as a private people, but also for companies, because Formula One is really ensuring success on the limit, and there are a lot of good lessons learned, especially for companization, non-profit organizations, whatever.
Yeah, and definitely, and the year. I think we talked a lot about corporate culture and how, you know, Formula One showed some examples of very good ways of understanding how to work with corporate culture and how to solve problems effectively using corporate culture as an instrument. Yeah, definitely.
Yes, and I think especially the companies we talked about are very good examples how their engagement into motorsports supported their sustainable success as a company.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I guess that's all we've got, right?
On this for today.
And we talked about quite a few things today, so we hope you liked it, and do let us know what you think about corporate culture and Formula One, and share your ideas with us, and we'll see you next time.
Yeah,
thanks a lot.
Bye bye.